The session will be delivered by eminent resource persons from various institute of repute. This FDP is of 5 days from January 3rd to January 7, 22, and we will cover the following topics. On day one, we will cover various emerging materials for semiconductor devices by Dr. Lakshman Raju Thotam and their characterization using DFT by Dr. Shyan Kanungo from BITS Pilani Hyderabad campus. On day two, we will be having Dr. Shubham Tayal, Dr. Ashutosh Nandi from NIT Kurukshetra and Dr. Shikhar Gupta from IIT Roorkee to discuss about advanced FET devices and their modeling. Day three, we will be having sessions on interconnect and their modeling by Dr. R. Shashank and Dr. Sandeep Bhattacharya. We also have a session on 2D materials for magnetic tunnel junctions by Dr. Shweta Meena from NIT Kurukshetra. On day four, we will have session on FET devices for low power and high frequency applications by Dr. Abhishek Acharya from SVNIT Surat, Dr. Ajayan from SR University, and we also have a session on solar cell designing by Dr. Devaraj Muchahari from NIT Raipur. Day five, we will be having Dr. Shubham Sahai from IIT Kanpur and Dr. KP Pradhan from IIITDM Kachipuram to give their thought on neuromorphic computing. And after that, we will have valediction section. Once again, I welcome you all to this 5-day FTB. Now, over to Leo sir once again. Thank you for joining this FTB.
Thank you, Shubham sir, for convening this FTP formally. Now I request our HOD ma'am, Dr. Usha Desa, to deliver his welcome address. Please, ma'am.
Good morning and New Year wishes to all. On behalf of SR University, I, Dr. Usha Desai, Professor and Head, Electronics and Communication Engineering, extend a warm welcome to you all for this IIT-sponsored one-week FTP on next generation materials and devices. I took privilege to welcome our Honorable Chancellor, Sri Varadha Reddy, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. J.R.C. Reddy, and our beloved Dean, School of Engineering, Dr. Vijaya Guntur, Program Coordinators, Dr. Shubham Tayal and Dr. Leo Joseph, and all the heads, deans, directors, and faculties to this inaugural function. I extend my warm welcome to our invited speakers and all the participants, and I'm grateful for the participants for showing interest towards this event. This is the right time to highlight about our department. EC is an esteemed department in the SR University, Warangal, with well-equipped state-of-the-art labs and team of experienced and dynamic faculties. Presently, our department is running UG specialization in electronics and communication engineering, and EC with AI and ML, and EC with IoT. Total intake of 300 students. And PG specializations in electronic design technology and embedded systems, and also has PhD programs. Our department is having a center of excellence in embedded systems and IoT. And the center focuses on research projects, internships, and startups. The department is well known for its innovative curriculum and implementation of outcome-based education. The best practice of our department is project-based learning and implementation of experimental learning strategies for the benefit of students. Our department has received DST-funded projects, and we are happy to organize this online FTP in association with IIT. And I am sure this event will enlighten valuable ideas about upcoming techniques and research developments in VLSI domain for the participants, faculties, and research scholars. Once again, I welcome you all for this event and my best wishes for the great success of the event. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your valuable welcome address. Now I request our Dean School of Engineering, Dr. Vijay Gunduru sir, to deliver his inaugural address. Please, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Leo, Honorable Vice Chancellor, respected colleagues, especially the participants who are making this program to run through, and a number of experts, as well a lot of departments well within SRU who have been supporting us to run this program. I really wish them all a joyous and healthy new year 2022. It's a right time that Dr. Shubham, the coordinator, has planned this particular program. I just recently found out in my interactions with him that the areas in which he is trying to offer you the content of the FDP is very, very, very important areas. Without materials, without proper devices, it is not easy to face today's challenges. Challenges are manifold. And when you look at the projection, only for power electronic devices alone, by the year 2030, I'm just talking about a projection in next 8 years, by a reputed MIT-based researchers, they say that 80% of the US electricity is expected to flow through only power electronics. 80% of the US electricity, of all whatever they generate, is expected to flow through power electronics. But the challenge is, do we have such a technology, such a material, such a devices, and what are the challenges in trying to meet their requisite higher efficiency and smaller form factor? Those are the primary things as far as power electronics. I'm just talking about one area. There are a number of fields, including biomedical electronics, especially the wearable biomedical electronics, where currently I am actually working on. There are separate set of material systems and devices being planned. I'm not saying this. This is again coming up from a Journal of Wearable Bioelectronics of 2020. There's the latest article I'm talking about. So a finding in the latest article. They are able to see that these are not easy unless we come up with, again, rethinking research of suitable materials for these particular devices. So I have actually forwarded a 5-page document to the coordinator with a request to share it with you all at an appropriate time. Maybe when I get a chance later, I'll come back to this document and discuss the details. For now, I'm glad to introduce the School of Engineering. Leo, I don't think this document is required at this point. For now, I would like to introduce the School of Engineering at SRU, where I am trying to lead it with 4 departments, EEE, ECE, Mechanical, and Civil Engineering. We have excellent center of excellences for attached to each department. And we have a wonderful foundation courses support from a separate School of Sciences, which will help us to train the 10+2 grad students from in their first year, and they give them to us in the second, third, and fourth year. We are trying our level best to make them, transform them into the bachelor degree holders, and we want to see that their effectiveness with the world community as well as the industry, that once in the convocation, our Vice Chancellor charges them the first batch, we want them to be befittingly so, and we are trying all our efforts to do so. So this is a brief introduction. I can speak a lot, but I know the time is limited. I would like to come back and then interact with you if there are any panel discussions. Maybe coordinator might have thought of arranging it sometime. Maybe we'll see at the time. Else, I am really thankful for the opportunity provided to me and the resources provided by the SR University for making or mounting this particular inauguration. Thank you very much. Over to Mr. Dr. Leo.
Thank you, sir, for your answers. Now we are very proud to have our honorable Vice Chancellor at this auspicious moment. Now I request
Okay, thank you, Dr. Leo. The topic, next generation materials and devices, is a very, very important topic in the present context, in the sense traditionally, you know, we are good always in software, but not in hardware. New materials are coming, you know. First discovery was, you know, silicon, germanium, which were found to be useful in electrical sciences and other areas. After that, you know, there is a lot of progress in leaps and bounds. And latest materials on which people are working, you know, like graphene, carbon nanotubes, nanowires, etc. Just now, I know Dr. Vijay also mentioned biomaterials. These are the very latest materials. Unfortunately, you know, we are lacking in this country, we are lacking in material science. Our contribution or research in this area in material science is not much. Even in 21st century, you know, not many chips are being made in this country. Even small countries like Singapore, Taiwan, you know, they make chips. In fact, we design and outsource them for making. It's very unfortunate. Unless software and as well as hardware, they go hand in hand, difficult for the country, you know, to progress. In this context, I think the topic, next generation materials and devices, very, very important. I am no expert in this, but I already, you know, I heard Dr. Shubham Thayar and Dr. Vijaya and Dr. Usha Desai, they spoke at length about the materials. I'm happy that, you know, there are many experts giving lectures, you know, from various NITs, including IITs. It is something very welcome. I'm also, you know, happy to note that about 42 participants are there from across the country. I think about across the country, you know, there are many people from Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Haryana, Orissa, Karnataka and Rajasthan. So I think this is the first FDP program is being conducted by this department. And it evoked really, you know, good response. I hope all the participants will benefit immensely through this MTP program. I wish all the participants the best. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. Keeping this in mind, I think researchers and project developers may enrich themselves in their by means of this FDP with that accident. Thank you, sir. At the vote of thanks, organization is our prime. It comes to, due to motivation and support of our management and higher authorities. I hereby express my heartfelt thanks to our Honorable Chancellor for his continuous inspiration by all means. Thank you for your inspirational support, sir. It's my privilege to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor for his encouragement and support in conducting this event. Our sincere thanks to you, sir. I thank our respected registrar, respected Dean Academics for their encouragement and support through this event, towards this event. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. I thank our respected Dean School of Engineering for his experiential inputs and guidance in convening this event. Thank you for your valuable guidance, sir. I thank our head of the department for extending her support in organizing this event. Thank you, ma'am. I thank deans of various schools, heads of all departments for their kind presence and encouragement. I thank our faculties for their moral support towards managing this event. I thank all participants for their kind interest, and we are on board due to your active presence only. Our sincere thanks and wishes to you. I thank everyone behind this event for the kind cooperation. Thank you very much once again. We formally start the event session hereby. Now, I request our convener, Dr. Shubham Tayal, sir, to showcase some of the instructions towards this FDP to the participants.
Thank you, Leo, sir. As a convener or as a faculty, I just assume that all the faculty members as well as all the participants will be benefiting from this FDP. As we are providing some e-certificates for this FDP, the criteria for that is there should be minimum 75% attendance. It is, I know everybody is well known, but only just to make the participant very active, we have made this criteria. A feedback link will be shared after every sessions in a WhatsApp group as well as in the chat box. So I request all the participants to join the WhatsApp group. The link has already been shared through mail to all the participants. The feedback link will be shared in the WhatsApp group as well as in the chat box. Please don't forget to give the feedback for every speaker that gives us an intuition that how we can improve it further in our future FDPs. Please, just as a convener, we want it should be an active participation. Thank you from my side. Now I would like to call Dr. Leo Joseph, sir, to introduce our keynote speaker, that is Dr. Lakshman Raju Thotap. Over to Leo, sir. Thank you.
I feel privileged to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Lakshman Raj Thotap. Dr. Lakshman Raj Thotap is working as assistant professor at SR University, Warangal. Dr. Thotap has more than 10 years of clean room fab experience in fabrication and characterization of reliable micron and nanoscale functional devices for electronics application. His primary research focuses on to study, analyze, and understand the electronic transport properties of low-dimensional material systems. Dr. Thotap did his postdoctoral research on the synthesis and characterization of high-quality complex oxide thin films and heterostructures of ultra-wide bandgap semiconductors at University of Minnesota. He received his PhD in nanoscience the year of 2016 and Master of Science in Electrical Engineering by 2011 from Northern Illinois University, DeKalb, Illinois, USA. His experiential research results are published in high-impact journals and serves as a referee for many international reputable journals and worked as committee member for international material science conferences and workshops. Dr. Thautam recently published a book chapter with CRC Press and currently serves as a book editor with Springer Nature Publication. His present research area includes implementation of novel electrostatic gating techniques to different material systems to explore structure property relationships. We feel proud to have Dr. Thautam on board. Now I request Dr. Thautam to take the session. Dr. Thautam, the session is yours. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Leo, sir, for the nice and beautiful introduction. A very good warm welcome to all the participants. I wish you a happy new year to start off with. Are you all, can you hear me, right? I'm just testing. Hello? Hello, sir? Hello? 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 Can you hear me, guys?
Hello, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible.
It is audible.
Yes, sir. It's audible.
Okay. Thank you. Let me share my screen. Can you see my screen? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let's kickstart this program with this session, and the session's title is Emerging Materials and Roadmap to Future Technologies. So as you have seen in the introductory sessions, many people, like including Vice Chancellor Sir, Dean Sir, HOD Madam, and Convener itself, spoke at length about why we are looking for alternate materials or why we are looking for new materials. That is, if you simply analyze, sit back and relax and think, I'm showing you three different examples. The first example is at a small scale, single electron transistor that we all know, MOSFET, TFET, many types of it, and the simplistic and the most smaller version of that is single electron transistor, wherein you have one electron moving here and there and performing transistor action. This is at a smaller scale. And if you just step up to the next version, then there is a technology called as MEMS, microelectrical mechanical systems, wherein you are using these MEMS sensors. I hope everyone is using these sensors in their day-to-day life. These are mostly used for sensing applications to give out some data. And if I take up it a notch, thanks to, we had a very wonderful last year, and this is mainly due to the space exploration. Many companies like SpaceX from Tesla, Amazon's Blue Origin, and Richard Branson's Virgin Atlantic flew up to space. And what is common in all these is, what is common in all these technologies, it might be at smaller scale, medium scale, or large scale, is materials. If you want to make a single electron transistor, what you need? You need a material which is so small. Take the example of graphene. And if you want to make a sensor, you need a sensor that has the capability to sense something. Again, if I go back to the fundamental definition of a sensor is a device which converts any physical quantity to electrical quantity. So what a sensor is doing is, it is taking some data, physical data, it might be temperature, pressure, gas, pollution, or any other thing, and it is giving out it to equivalent voltage signals. And by taking those voltage values, we are making real-time applications. And if you really think of space exploration, Tesla, take the example of Tesla, SpaceX. What is a rocket made up of? Aluminum alloys. Then what is so special about aluminum alloys? These are very lightweight, and engineers within the SpaceX are coming up with different versions of alloys, alloying them at different conditions to make it more robust, more lightweighter, and more reliable. And everybody talks about Tesla. Whenever people talk about SpaceX, people talk about only space as well as Tesla cars. But do you know that Tesla has its own materials engineering company, which works on their own materials to improve the reliability and efficiency of the existing materials? And right from nanometer scale, which is of graphene, to centimeter scale, all I can say are kilometer scale, everything is dependent on material technology. What are the available materials you have in your hand and how you are working with them? And this also, I also want to emphasize that material science is not unique. It's not on its own. It is interdisciplinary. It combines bio, It combines chemical, it combines optical, all these different fields come together to take the advantage of available materials and come up with applications So I hope you have all seen the periodic table, right? This is a different version of a periodic table wherein I am just trying to show you some common elements that we use in our day-to-day life. So here is a periodic table version by European Chemical Society. They put up this periodic table, and in this periodic table there are only 90 natural elements that are mostly used in our day-to-day life. And the size of each box represents its abundance. Let's say hydrogen, let's say silicon, which is green in color, let's say oxygen, which is green in color. These are very, very abundant. And the color orange and the color yellow are limited supplies, which are present on our nature. So, and you can also see a symbol, just to see, give you a practical intuition of what I'm talking about. They also put up a picture of cell phone. Wherever there is a cell phone, that represents that particular element is used in making a cell phone. And you can see cell phone symbol at hydrogen, oxygen, potassium, phosphorus, silicon. And also you can see it at indium. And see, the indium is orange in color. That means there is a threat to this material. This is very limited in supply. So in coming years, if we try to use the cell phones in the same manner, this material will become obsolete. Then are we running out of cell phones? Do we stop making cell phones? No. What we do look for extension for new, or we look for alternate materials which does the same purpose as that of indium. Just to give you a more intuition of where indium is used in the world, this is a picture from National Renewable Energy Laboratory from USA. They had come up with this report wherein they presented the use of indium in different areas of applications. As you can see, most of the indium is used in flat panel display that I hope many of you are right now using your cell phones. The screen which you are touching is a flat panel display, and in that there is some sort of an indium present in there. And also you can see other areas where you can see indium, like LEDs, alloys, batteries, thermal interface, photovoltaics, and other. But major chunk of indium is going to flat panel displays. And in those flat panel display, indium is combined with tin oxide. And this is the most common transparent conducting oxide that is currently used for making flat panel displays. You take an LED, you take a smartphone, you take a computer screen, everywhere there is a chunk of ITO present, indium tin oxide. But as you might have noticed, everybody is using cell phones, everybody is using touch screens. So with this expected usage, indium is going to be depleted of its natural resources in the coming years. So what we do, we cannot make up new indium. The only other solution is to look for alternate materials. And who is going to replace ITO is the big question. Who is going to replace the ITO question? So when you simply talk about ITO in general, which is a transparent semiconductor, it has high electrical conductivity, high optical transparency, These two are the material aspect in the sense every material has its own characteristics. So ITO is having these two characteristics, which is making very, very useful for itself to be used as a flat panel display. And the other advantage of ITO is ease of deposition, because remember in the previous screen, major chunk is used as a flat panel display, where is a touch screen. And if you touch, if you see your mobile phones, that touch screen is a simple, very thin layer which is coated on the top side of your screen. So that is a very, very thin film. So you want this ITO in the form of thin films. And this thin film is made use with respect to different deposition techniques, physical vapor deposition techniques, wherein they have the capacity to deposit these ITO in the range from 1 nanometer, 2 nanometer, 3 nanometer, 4 nanometer, up to hundreds of nanometer. Precisely, you can control how much of ITO you want on a particular device. This is more of a technological aspect. The first two are the material aspect, which is making it very useful. And the second one is also very, very important criteria when coming when you are talking about commercialization, because whenever you are making a product commercial, it needs to be technologically feasible. And if I simply put up a graph on the x-axis as cost and y-axis on the conductivity, ITO is sitting right at the sweet spot. ITO is rightly sitting at the sweet spot where it has decent conductivity and moderate cost. And when you talk about flat panel displays, ITO is not the only element. There are also conductive polymers. There are silver nanowires. There are carbon nanotubes. So these all materials have also come up into the picture, and are trying hard to replace ITO. And then came the other wonder element. Then came the other wonder element, which is called as graphene, which has exactly identical properties as that of indium tin oxide. Yes, it has high electrical conductivity and it has high optical transparency. And you can see just on the just schematically, you can see how graphene's conductivity is varying from a low conductivity value to a high conductivity value. So different applications require different conductivity values. So graphene gives you that advantage. So for the next 15 minutes or so, I would focus on graphene and just give you an insight of what graphene can offer at the material level, what graphene can offer at material level. So coming to just a brief introduction of graphene, graphene is a monolayer atom of carbon. So graphene, whatever, carbon is nothing but a pencil, graphite, a diamond, graphite. So if you take the pencil, this pencil, which is made up of carbon atoms, is connected very strongly in plane, and in out of the plane, they are connected very, very weak using van der Waal forces. Van der Waal forces are very weak forces and they can be easily broken apart. Since this graphene is only one atomic layer thick, it is perfectly two-dimensional material. It is an absolute two-dimensional material wherein it has x coordinate, y coordinate, but no z coordinate. But all the other elements that I spoke about, it might be it might be pencil or it might be graphite, it has both x, y and z coordinate. But this graphene doesn't have z coordinate. And the beauty of this graphene is, it is, since I said graphene is obtained from graphite, and in graphite the atoms along the c-axis are bonded very, very weakly using van der Waal forces, which can be broken apart. That is, so this is a picture of Kitsch graphite. This is a picture of bulk Kitsch graphite. And what you do is, you simply take a scotch tape. You simply take a scotch tape and you just peel it. See, you see there are different black versions of different amounts of carbon present on the scotch tape. Then what you do is, you put that scotch tape on a silicon wafer. And you put that scotch tape on a silicon wafer. And here is an optical image I am showing you. The pinkish color is the SiO2 layer, silicon dioxide, the most common substrate that we use for making devices. And whenever you exfoliate or whenever you put that scotch tape onto the SiO2, you can see different versions, different colors. You can see different colors. Those different colors correspond to different thicknesses of graphite. I am very weak at colors. The greener is around 10 to 20 nanometers. The bluer is around 10 to 15. The dark blue is greater than 20. And if you also see, there are some very, very light transparent colors. Say, for example, here, this is very transparent. This is very transparent. So this corresponds to graphene. This corresponds to graphene, monolayer of carbon atom. And due to this unique monolayer feature or one atomic thick, it has very different band structure when compared to other traditional elements. And due to this, its ultra thin nature and its different and unique novel band structure, it possesses very important characteristics like ambipolar conduction. It can conduct electrons or it can conduct holes. High mobility of charge carriers. The electrons move at a very, very faster speed. Ballistic transport, that is essentially they can move at a speed of light, 3×10⁸. And they have readily accessible two-dimensional electron carriers, not buried in a heterostructure. And also it gives you an added advantage of tuning the carriers from different 10⁻¹ to 10⁻¹³ square centimeters as per your requirement. So how can you do that? How can the tunability comes? So this is the traditional semiconductor. I hope you all have seen this picture many a times in your textbooks. You have a valence band, you have a conduction band, and then you have a forbidden energy gap for metals, it coincides, for insulators, it's very large. And for semiconductors, it's so small, just with a little excitation or with external doping, you can move carriers from bottom to top, and that's how you get your conductivity. So the beauty of graphene is this unique 2D structure gives graphene an edge, and its structure looks something like this, wherein the top of the valence bond and bottom of the conduction band touch at a point in its band structure, and this point is called as Dirac point, where it has zero density of states, and now what you can do is, now that the Fermi level is exactly sitting at the Dirac point, just by using field effect gating, just like what you do in MOSFET devices, you apply a gate voltage, that gate voltage will induce carriers. So you can apply the same principle here and move your Fermi level either into the conduction band or into the valence band. If you move into the conduction band, you are populating electrons into the picture, and if you are moving into a valence band, you are populating whole carriers into the picture. So this graphene gives you an added control. Yes, it has unique structure, which is touching at one singular point, and that singular point is Dirac point. And the second advantage is you can modulate the type of carriers as per your requirement. And if you simply take fundamental equations, conductivity according to Dudo conductivity, sigma is equals to Ne mu. Sigma corresponds to conductivity, N corresponds to density of carriers, E is charge, mu is mobility. At Dirac point, you have very minimal carrier densities, and your conductivity is majorly dependent on mobility. And mobility is given as mu is equals to E tau by M. E is charge of an electron, tau is the mean free path, and M is the effective mass. It so happens in graphene, let me get back to semiconductors for a while. You take standard silicon, it's a semiconductor itself. It's an intrinsically, it's a semiconductor. Then you dope it. Whenever you are doping it to donate a free electrons, that dopant is also sitting in the silicon atom, and that dopant will act as a scattering center. And that how its mean free path would be varying depending upon how much of dopants you have and what is the type of dopant. But in graphene, you don't have that picture here. Simply by using gating effect, you are putting more carriers. So that mean free path would be very, very long. And the effective mass, and the effective mass is the mass of the carrier when subjected to periodic potential, is expected to go to very, very minimal values. So due to that, the mobility of the graphene can reach up to tens of thousands at room temperature. Just to give you a picture of silicon has a room temperature mobility of 1400 or 2000, but graphene's mobility can reach up to tens of thousands, 10,000. And to the best of my knowledge, the highest reported graphene's mobility is 20,000 at room temperature. See, now with that mobility, if you make a device out of that, that device will definitely outperform silicon in terms of performance, in terms of on-off ratios, in terms of speed, in terms of sensitivity. So this is how the graphene is giving its advantages over traditional elements. Now that we have seen basically what graphene is, what graphene offers from the outside, let's go into device making process. Yes, you have a material which is offering very good features, high mobility, tunability, and the next thing is, if you want to make a device, what is the procedure involved? So first, what you do is, as I said, you take a scotch tape and put it on SiO2, and then your job is to locate where the graphene is. This is not straightforward way. This is like trial and error method. You need to locate that, and because imagine now you are putting. Let me say you have a cricket field. In that cricket field, you are putting a ball at near the stumps. If you are on the pitch, it's very easy. But if you're looking from the spectator view, you cannot really pinpoint where the ball is. So that's how, that is a difficult process. So what you do is, here you can see alignment marks or pluses marks. These grid marks will at least give an idea of sensing where that graphene is. After you locate that exact point, you do lithography. Lithography is a process of designing something at micro scale or nano scale. And here you can see on top of graphene, I put four contacts. Two contacts are used as source and drain, and other two contacts are used for sensing the resistance across the device. And finally, you deposit contacts, titanium gold in this case, and you pump current from left to right, and you observe or you characterize how the device performs at nanoscale. And in terms of doping, in terms of gating, so this is what, if you are looking from a side view, you have SiO2, on SiO2 you have graphene, on graphene you have contacts, which acts as source and drain contacts, but this SiO2 is put on a P-type silicon. Now, the combination of P-type silicon, SiO2 and graphene acts as a capacitor, which exactly mimics your MOSFET devices, wherein you have in channel region between source and drain, you have gate oxide, SiO2 and top metal contact, exactly the same thing here. So the amount of carriers induced into the graphene is equals to, given by this fundamental equation, induced carriers is equals to capacitance times applied gate voltage over electron. And by different gate voltages, either you can get electrons or you can get holes. Either you can get electrons or you can get holes. So here is a simple picture I'm showing you. So in the inset, you can see the image of a graphene device. That is a false color image. That means I tweaked it just to highlight where graphene is, because graphene is transparent. Whenever you take a picture, it's very, very difficult to pinpoint where graphene is in the picture. So that is the reason I alter the pictures, and the dark gray color between the source and drain contacts is the graphene, and the left and right is source and drain contacts. And whenever I'm on, and here is a plot which shows R versus VG, that is gate voltage is present on the left axis and the change in resistance is plotted on the Y axis. As I'm moving from 0 to 60 or minus 60, you can see how the resistance is varying, the resistance initially, so at zero condition, at zero voltage, your Dirac point should be at 0 volt. But here if you see the Dirac point or the charge neutrality point is shifted to 40 volts. So what is happening here? I said graphene should be having a Dirac point, both conduction band and valence band should touch, and it should have no density of carriers. But even at 0 volts, you are getting some conductivity. This is due to whenever you are putting this graphene on SiO2, the interface between graphene and SiO2 should be contaminant free, because graphene is a 2D material at nanoscale. It offers high surface to volume ratio. Any contaminants which is present within its vicinity, it tends to react and it tends to absorb those molecules in the graphene, and that's how its Dirac point changes. And since you are making a device, the graphene has to undergo through certain steps, which is what I showed you in the previous slide. So in each step, it is exposed to different chemicals. And here, this device is specifically made using Shipley 1813 positive photoresist. And you can see the Dirac point shifted to positive voltages, surface contamination, and photoresist residues drastically change the location of Dirac point. And also you can see a small hysteresis between forward sweep and backward sweep. And all these are due to presence of trap charges and dangling bonds between graphene and SiO2. Now, if you want to make a device out of graphene, where should be your Dirac point? It should be at zero. So this is more of a process issue. Wherein your process should be ultra clean to make superior devices. So material is having its full potential, but what we are lacking here is technological issue in terms of process parameters. Now, I am showing another device. Here is another graphene device. Again, this is made using a better process. In the previous case, I used a photoresist of Shipley 1813, but here I use a photoresist called an e-beam resist called as PMMA, which is an organic compound which is used for e-beam lithographical process. Somehow, the affinity towards graphene and photoresist, Shipley photoresist, is stronger when compared to affinity versus graphene versus PMMA. And that's how you can see the Dirac point is closer to 0 volts, and the curve is symmetrical between negative and positive gate voltages. Now, this looks great. Yes, I got a graphene device which I can readily modulate. But what is the thickness of graphene? Ultra thin nature, one atomic thick, 0.35 angstroms. So whenever you are making devices, here is a very good picture taken. I like this picture very, very a lot, because this gives you a practical intuition of whenever you say that the device is burning out. So at macroscopic scale, this is the same image I measured, and due to some electrostatic discharge ESD effects, these ESD effects are very, very, very important in making a reliable devices. So whenever a company or Intel or AMD or any other Micron companies are coming up with devices, they will make sure that your device is ESD sensitive. That is, any electrostatic discharges would not damage your device. Because we are in the winter season, I'll give you a very good example. Now it's outside, it's very cold. We all use blankets. Now, if you continuously use blanket, the physical contact between you and the blanket, if it is made of a perfect wool, very good quality, you will see some sparks. That is what basically an ESD charges. So with respect to that ESD charges, because this is very sensitive, the device breaks. Yes, graphene offers very good material properties, but when coming to making a device, the device basically, whenever you're making a device, you look at production yields, you look at manufacturing cost, you look at product reliability, profitability, and quality. Material is of highest quality, but if you are failing in making an effective device, that material is of no use. That is the reason graphene research has started, in 1990s, but till now, there is no large scalability. There are specific applications of graphene being a device, but there is no large scale uses of graphene on the whole giving reliable results. Yes, there are one or two applications here and there which are working, but it's not as good as silicon based devices. So this is also again a technological issue that we need to overcome in the coming years to come up with reliable devices. Now that I have shown you a basic picture of, yes, you can use graphene as a device at nanoscale, let me give you a physical intuition of how you can change graphene's properties. As the Dirac point is touching at the conduction band and valence band edge, it should have no conductivity, zero conductivity. But due to this unwanted doping at the interface, you have some doping. Now, what I'm trying to do is, yes, I take the same picture, but on top of graphene, I put some superconducting material. Just to give you what a superconductivity is. Superconductivity is a material which offers zero resistance. Now, I try to enforce superconducting properties into graphene. Is this possible? Let's see. So the logic is very simple. Graphene you have underneath, and on top of graphene, you have these superconducting islands sitting. And within this, each blue shaded region is a superconducting region. Locally, it is superconducting. And what is superconductivity? Superconductivity is flow of electrons in bunches, which are called as Cooper pairs, without collision. So those electrons within the blue islands have Cooper pairs, and the length through which they travel before losing this coherence is called as coherence length. That length is maximum within the dot, within the blue region. But when it comes outside the blue region, It is seeing graphene. Graphene doesn't possess superconductivity properties. But if you place those dots close enough, it's like tunneling. The electrons can tunnel through the graphene and reach the other superconducting island. In that way, you are making macroscopically the entire sheet of graphene as superconductivity. And here is a device. Here is an experimental evidence of that. So here is the blue, the black region is the graphene. And again, I have source and drain contacts to voltage contacts. And this is an optical image picture on which you can see the yellow ones are the contacts, titanium gold contacts. Underneath, you have graphene. And on top of graphene, you have nice lithographically placed superconducting dots. And here I use a superconducting material called as molybdenum germanium, which is a type 2 superconductor and which superconducts around 6 Kelvin. And if you look at the graph here, resistance from room temperature is slightly increasing in the normal state, and when it reaches characteristic temperature, you can see the complete heterostructure has gone down to zero. So in principle, by using these dots, I have made graphene as superconducting. Just to give you physics behind what is happening here, let me take another simplistic example wherein I have niobium, which is a superconducting material, deposited on gold substrate. Gold is a conductor, niobium is an island. So what usually happens is, in region one, you have this gray superconducting islands on gold background. In normal state, above the characteristic temperature, both niobium and gold are in normal state, and that's how you have definitive normal state finite resistance. But once you reach a point where niobium starts to superconducting, First, the grains within the superconductor try to go into superconducting phase. So that's the reason first you see an initial drop. First you see an initial drop at T1. As you further decrease the temperature, the coherence of this superconducting behavior within the grain increases, and in the region 3, intergranular coherence will establish. And once you further cool, finally all of them at region 4, all of the islands starts to communicate with respect to each other using gold substrate, and that's how macroscopic superconductivity is achieved. And the coherence length that I'm talking about is given by the fundamental equation H bar, Planck's constant, D is the normal metal diffusion constant, KB is Boltzmann's constant, T is temperature. And if you want to understand the intricate relationship between the superconductivity versus metallic nature, what you need to do is you need to repeat the same experiment of niobium islands on gold, platinum, silver, because every material has different diffusion constants. Every material has different metal diffusion constants. But on the other hand, if you do the same niobium experiment on a graphene, what does graphene offer you? Graphene offers a picture of varying the conductivity. As you are varying the conductivity using gate voltage, you can vary the diffusion constants. As you vary the diffusion constants, your coherence length will increase. As you vary the coherence length, your superconductivity parameters like transition temperature and critical carrier density can modulate. So this is the advantage of graphene in this set of experiments. So again, the same thing, you start off with a device, make a lithographical device, and this is an SEM picture. This is an SEM picture wherein you can see the device in four probe contacts. And on top of that, there is a second lithographical step. So you can see dots, and these are MOGE islands, molybdenum germanium islands. Intrinsically, when you pristinely measure MOGE, it superconducts around 6 Kelvin, as you can see in this right-hand side graph. From normal state transport, if you decrease the temperature, right around 6 Kelvin, it goes into superconducting states. Now, the effect is, now what we are trying to do is, let's see if graphene does this. Let's see if graphene can inherent or take the properties of this superconductivity, absorb in itself, and make it a superconductor. So here are R versus temperature, resistance versus temperature curves at different gate voltages. So what I try to do is I try to modulate, do the experiment different gate voltages, in a way giving different diffusion constants in terms of different conductivities. And here you can see the curves are not going to superconducting states. The curves are, resistance curves are not going to, so if I just zoom in one of the curve at minus 10 VG, you can see initially the resistance is around 700, right around 6 Kelvin, where this MOGE is superconducting, you see a drop. You see a drop of 20 ohms. This drop corresponds to the drop within the drop offered by MOGE, but somehow it might be the spacing or it might be the residues that is limiting graphene to take its properties. So we did not, in this experiment, I did not achieve global superconductivity, but local superconductivity is observed within the MOGE. We are still working on to achieve global superconductivity in graphene. This example, I'm just showcasing this example to show how you can modulate or how you can initiate different properties into existing materials, into new materials using lithographical techniques. So that being said, not only superconductivity, you can do the same thing with ferromagnetic materials. You take two superconducting materials or ferromagnetic materials, put them so close to each other so that graphene acquires those properties, and by using the modulating properties of graphene, you can change the superconducting properties as the entire, or you can change a ferromagnetic properties as an entire system. So here is an example I'm showing you of superconductivity in graphene and tin islands. And you can see the two-step curve. Above the dashed line is the first where the tin is superconducting, and below the dashed line, the entire system is superconducting. And by using different gate voltages, you can see the TC, or the characteristic temperature, is varied from 1.5 Kelvin to 2.5 Kelvin. Similarly, you can do the same thing for ferromagnetism. You put, instead of superconducting dots, now put cobalt, which is a magnetic element, on top of the graphene, and try to inculcate or absorb the properties. And this is a room temperature magnetism in graphene and cobalt based heterostructures. So this material can be engineered to show it as an insulator, to show it as a superconductor or to show it as a ferromagnet. Normally, if you want a different applications, different materials, you choose for material X for superconductor, material Y for ferromagnet, material Z for insulator. But this graphene can do everything in single place. That is the importance of graphene. So these superconductivity and ferromagnetism, yes, they have their limited applications, but it's more of what science-based experiments. Now let me give you an physical use or an actual use where you can use graphene as a sensor, graphene as a magnetic sensor. So all magnetic sensors use the changing resistance of a material in presence of magnetic field in one way or the other way. So magnetoresistance is defined as change of electrical resistance of a material with applied magnetic field, with applied magnetic field. So you can derive or you can quantify it as MR is equals to del rho, change in resistivity, that is rho of H, change in resistance in presence of magnetic field, minus rho naught, which is zero field resistivity over zero field resistivity. Normally in metals, ordinary MR is due to orbital motion of electrons. We have all studied in our plus 12, electrons tend to travel in straight lines. Whenever you apply a magnetic field, they try to curve. So that is given by this simple equation, F is equals to Q times E. But when you apply a magnetic field, those electrons follow bending motion or helical motion, and that helicity is given by EH by M star C. That helicity of a particular electron is given, of a particular electron in a particular material, is given as EH by M star C. And here is a graph which I am showing you the magnetoresistance properties of different material systems, different elemental metals. Different elemental metals have different amount of magnetoresistance, and they all depend upon material properties, going back to M star effective mass. But graphene, M star is almost close to zero, so your omega C is infinite. So if your omega C is infinite, it takes larger helical paths. As it takes larger helical paths, its effective magnetoresistance should be higher. And if you take the example of bismuth, which is showing very high magnetoresistance in this picture, bismuth is a semi-metal which has equal number of electrons and holes with highly anisotropic Fermi surface, low carrier concentrations, long carrier free path, and small effective carrier mass. Look at the terms, low carrier concentrations. Yes, you have very low carrier concentrations in graphene at charge neutrality point. Long carrier mean free path. Yes, there are no external dopants, so your mean free path is longer, and smaller effective carrier. Yes, your effective mass is so small at the direct point. So with this motive, we can expect graphene to have very high magnetoresistance. And not only this ordinary MR can also be obtained by, just to give you an additional information, you have anisotropic magnetoresistance, wherein magneto MR changes with respect to applied current and magnetic field. GMR, giant magnetoresistance, wherein you take magnetic layer, insulating layer, magnetic layer, and you apply it. There you use spin mechanism, tunneling, wherein the electron can tunnel. So using these three phenomena also you can obtain MR. So here is an experimental result of graphene's MR in presence of magnetic field at different temperatures. As you can see, the maximum MR it can offer is only around 250% at room temperatures. But as you go down, the amount of MR is decreasing. Similarly, here is another picture wherein at 400 Kelvin, graphene deposited, or not deposited is not the right word, graphene put on SiO2 offers a magnetoresistance of only 300%. According to these properties, your graphene, that is long mean free path, small effective mass, low carrier concentration, your graphene should have high MR. But what so happens here is, whenever you are putting graphene on the SiO2, it is not ultra clean anymore. It is some sort of contamination, and that contamination limits this MR to nominal values at room temperatures. Or what you can do is, you can take graphene and put some magnetic elements, like here I decorated them with an experiment decorated with cobalt. Graphene on top of graphene, you have cobalt, and whenever the cobalt is present, you can see the MR is around 40%. So So what you can do is MR can be obtained as per this slide. MR can be obtained due to Lorentz force. MR can be obtained due to anisotropic magnitude resistance. MR can be due to GMR, giant magnitude resistance. MR can be due to tunneling. Or there is a very, very interesting paper, seminal paper by Professor Littlewood and Parrish from Argonne National Labs. What they said is, yes, you can also get MR. You can also get MR if you make your semiconductor disordered. Disorder in the sense, you put some disorder onto the homogeneous semiconductor. Whenever you make that semiconductor disturb local density of that is, what you do is you are intentionally putting disorder. Whenever you are intentionally putting disorder, electron moving freely without disorder now undergoes scattering with respect to different disorder locations, and it takes multiple scattering paths. And in terms of magnetic field, this further enhances that, and this this particular mechanism of inducing high MR in homogeneous semiconductors has been observed in many material systems. So using the same approach, what I did was, and again here I used graphene, which is the highlighted color. Again, the four probe measurements, and you can see the dots here. Again, I use MOGA dots. These dots will act as some sort of a disorder, because traditionally graphene is very free. But on top of graphene, I'm putting these dots, and these dots are 300 nanometer dot with 500 nanometer pitch. And here you can see the beauty. At no magnetic field, the red curve shows, even after putting disorder onto the graphene, graphene retains its pristine properties, that is ambipolar characteristics around Dirac point. But once you turn on the magnetic field, you see the jump in resistance. The resistance jumped from around 1 kilo ohm at 0 Tesla to 7 kilo ohm at 9 Tesla. The blue curve and the green curve are due to forward sweep and backward sweep. And you can also notice that right around the Dirac point, there is some sort of a hysteresis. So you can also use this hysteresis phenomenon to make a possible memory device. And not only at room temperatures, if you go down to 10 Kelvin, very extreme low temperatures, even then it shows the same increase in magnetoresistance in presence of magnetic fields. But the difference between room temperature magnetic MR and low temperature MR is, at low temperatures, additional quantum effects like SDH oscillations will come into picture, and these are periodic. That is the reason you get these periodic waveforms at low temperatures. To observe this quantum phenomenon, the thermal KBT energy should be very small. And that is the reason only at low temperatures you see this quantum behavior, but at room temperature, you don't see that quantum behavior. So, and not only that, at 300 Kelvin, you see a huge rise in MR, but is it really coming from graphene or is it coming from MOGA? To test that, we need to observe the change in magnetoresistance at different gate voltages. And here is a graph which shows resistance on the x-axis and magnetic field on the y-axis with different gate voltages. And whenever I'm applying different gate voltages, the amount of MR is changing. As you are going towards the Dirac point or the charge neutrality point, which is around -2 volts, the MR is higher. As you're moving away from the Dirac point, the MR tends to decrease. So MR is maximum around charge neutral point, and it decreases on either side of CNP due to population of charge carriers. So the gate tunability says that the obtained MR is coming from the intrinsic nature of graphene in presence of external disorder. But graphene is a 2D system. To further ascertain our results, graphene is a 2D system. So whenever you are applying magnetic field to a 2D system, only cosine component should contribute to MR. That is, whenever you apply magnetic field in parallel to the graphene sheet, no MR should be obtained. So here is an experiment that confirms that. At 165, 150, 180, 165, so I am coming from out of plane to in plane. Whenever you are in out of plane direction, your MR changes drastically. But whenever you are coming to in plane at 90 degrees, no change in MR is observed. So this again further confirms the intrinsic MR obtained here is coming from graphene in presence of external disorder. So here is an angle dependent magnetoresistance plotted at 300 Kelvin and 9 Tesla. MR as high as 650% is achieved at room temperature, and this MR increases to 1100% at low temperature. So you have highly tunable MR that can function at 300 Kelvin, that can function at 10 Kelvin, and between these also it can perform. But I'm just giving you some extreme values from room temperature to low temperature. So this gives out some interesting applications. Where do you use MR? Magnetic sensor. Right now I'm using my magnetic sensor during this presentation, which is coming from my hard disk. My hard disk has a readout sensor that works, that reads the information due to magnetism, and that's where this sensor can go in. And as I have rightly demonstrated, this sensor, this graphene-based sensor, works at room temperature, and at 10 Kelvin, it can undergo different temperature changes, and yet give out good readout values. Just to give you a physical picture, why this is important. Every one of us use our computer. Whenever we use computer with limited air flowing, your computer gets overheated. Whenever your computer gets overheated, your device starts to stuck. So your readout sensor is affected by those temperature variations. But if you use this MR graphene-based sensors, right from low temperatures to high temperatures, it can function equally. You need to do some sort of a temperature calibration to come out with this reliable measurements, and it is highly sensitive. That is 650% change. However, yes, this all looks beautiful with respect to the device level or a single sensor level. But what is majorly lacking in this graphene-based research is scalability. All the devices that I showed and all the results I explained so far are coming from exfoliated graphene, wherein the size of graphene device is typically less than 5 microns. But whenever you want to make a device, you want large scale. Right now, we are working on silicon-based chips. If you see silicon-based chips, they are circular in diameter, and there are 11 inch, 13 inch, 15 inch, 17 inch, 13 inch of silicon, uniform silicon is present. But in terms of graphene, that is like not possible at this point. Yes, research is trying to come up with large-scale graphene, like using techniques like chemical vapor deposition, but it is not to its full caliber. Once we reach to that particular issue, yes, graphene can be used, replace ITO or other common sensor optic. Again, this is a technological issue that we will overcome in coming years. Not only graphene, with respect to, after seeing the wonders obtained by this graphene, especially the 2D material, people started to look around in the periodic table. And new materials have come, new 2D materials have come up. So this is a periodic table where in the blue color, I'm showing you graphene-like elements like monolayer of boron, monolayer of carbon, monolayer of nitrogen, monolayer of phosphorus, silicene, which is a monolayer of silicon, germanine, which is a monolayer of germanium. Apart from that, you also have transition metal dichalcoxide elements, which has a transition metal, which is represented by a red color in the periodic table, and gray color MX2. And not only this, yes, we are working very, very, very hard to come up with new materials for advanced applications, Very recently, in the last few years, people are going crazy towards artificial intelligence and machine learning. These artificial intelligence and machine learning is everywhere now. It's like you open any field of science, it's there. So that has come even into material research, and artificial intelligence and machine learning programs are helping the material researchers to come up with discovery of new two-dimensional materials every day. And these are some classification of 2D materials available to date. This list is not exhaustive, but there are many other material systems which have come. You have graphene family, you have 2D chalcogenides, which have semiconductor, which have metallic, which are layered, and also you have 2D oxides. And this 2D family consists of metals, insulators, semiconductors, ferroelectric materials, ferromagnetic materials, superconductors, dielectric, you name anything, all are present in this particular chart. And the beauty of these 2D materials is these are nanoscale. When you exfoliate, they come in very small sizes. These will help in making nanoscale devices. And whenever you compare silicon-based or existing technology-based devices, and when you are trying to shrink it down, short channel effects, short channel effects and other effects are dominating now. So you cannot fundamentally go beyond, but these materials intrinsically will avoid those kind of an effects and increase the efficiency of your nanoscale devices. Now that I have shown you what graphene can offer, let me touch on a few other examples in the limited time I have, and let me showcase what wonders they can do. So I'll pick semiconductor dichalcogenide, and in this principally I'll select on tungsten ditelluride. So in the year 2014, I guess, right when I was doing my PhD, so a group from Princeton, from Professors Kawa, they discovered that MR, magnetoresistance in this material, is not saturating and it's continuously increasing. And you can see the ratio in the graphene I showed you earlier. The MR was 650% at room temperature, and at low temperatures it was 1100. But here in this material, it is 13,000,000% at a magnetic field of 60 Tesla and at a temperature of 0.53 Kelvin. So why? What is the reason of this high MR in this material? So it was so projected, or it was theoretical people did DFT calculations and found out that in this material, it so happens within the band structure, they have equal number of electrons and equal number of holes, making it as a semi-metal or a compensated material, wherein the number of holes is equals to number of electrons. Yes, number of electrons is equals to number of holes, but what does it offer? How does it is responsible in obtaining high MR? And to see the experimental confirmation of the same, here is a snapshot of angle resolved photoemission spectroscopy structural characterization picture of the size of electron pocket and hole pocket at 20 Kelvin, which shows equal size. But if you increase the temperature, the whole electron size is increasing and the hole size is decreasing. That means it only at low temperatures you have equal number of electrons and holes, but at high temperatures, as you are moving towards the elevated temperatures, the ratio of electrons and holes is changing. As it changes, your MR property should deviate. Let me put it in terms of equations, because we all like equations. We would love to see how an equation helps a particular phenomenon. So since here in this material you have an electron as well as and a hole, you have an electron as an a hole. Electron is a carrier, hole is a carrier. Two types of carriers are present. So the top equation gives you the equation of resistivity when you have two types of carriers. The real part gives resistivity and the imaginary part gives Hall resistance. So in the denominator, you can see N minus P. If N is equals to P, which is the case in this material, N is equals to P, number of electrons is equals to holes in this material, this denominator terms becomes zero, and your resistivity in presence of magnetic field is simply 1 plus mobility of electron times mobility of holes multiplied by magnetic field over a constant value. That is, your magnetic resistance in presence of magnetic field continuously increase as long as you are increasing the magnetic field. The resistance increases. That is the reason at low temperatures, you can see with that compensation being maintained, as long as you increase the magnetic field, the MR tends to increase. This report was present on a bulk centimeter scale picture. Since this tungsten telluride belongs to a 2D family, we take the advantage of mechanical exfoliation. Just like graphene, this is also weakly connected in C-axis, wherein just by using the Scotch tape, you can peel it. You can peel it and put it on a substrate. So here is one such example wherein I put tungsten ditelluride. This is 100 nanometer thick material on silicon dioxide. I characterize this material. So this is the temperature dependence of material, R versus T. As you decrease the temperature in zero field, your resistance decreases, conveying it as a metallic nature. But when you apply the magnetic field, your resistance starts to increase. And here is the second picture, shows you magnetic field dependence. The red curve corresponds to 10 Kelvin and the blue curve corresponds to 150 Kelvin. And you can see the drastic changes in the relative differences. At 10 Kelvin, you see a maximum change in resistance when you apply magnetic field when compared to 150 Kelvin. This is due to, again, At low temperatures, the compensation is maintained. You have high MR, but at high temperatures, the compensation is destroyed in terms of unequal distribution of charge carriers, and your MR tends to be very, very small. And if you plot MR versus field in terms of what is the behavior, all of these follow power law behavior. MR is equals to H square, just like this particular equation has said, MR is equals to H square. Yes, this looks all beauty, but can we really see, is the compensation is the only criteria that is making this MR high? To see that, again, since this is a 2D material, I made a very thin material, just like graphene, and used the same concept of back gating, just like SiO2. And so here's a pristine R versus T behavior. And since this is a 2D materials, again, out of plane, 180 degrees, maximum change, in plane, 90 degrees, no change, confirming the 2D nature of this particular material. So at 10 Kelvin, according to these reports, 20 Kelvin, you have equal number of electrons and holes. Below that, you also have the same thing. So what I did was, at 10 Kelvin, since this is in very thin nature, I started applying back gating. That is, I tried to put electrons and holes, just like in the graphene, into the picture and see the modulation of change in resistance. And you can clearly see there is some change. And at 10 Kelvin, in presence of magnetic field, at zero, you have maximum. Whenever you're populating the carriers, the MR decreases. Now, it is a very bulletproof, gunshot experimental verification saying that, yes, in order to have high MR in this material, perfect compensation should be maintained. And only at zero, you have maximum MR. As you are putting electrons or holes, the MR starts to deviate with respect to at low temperatures, if you vary the electron to hole ratio, the MR decreases. But if your electron to hole ratio is 1, it is maximum. And the MR also decreases with respect to temperature. MR also decreases with respect to temperature. At high temperatures, the perfect ratio of E to H is equals to 1 is lost, and you see a decrease in MR. But unfortunately in this material, the XMR, if you want to use this material as a magnetic sensor, you should only use it at low temperatures. That's where the interesting property comes. So if time permits, I think I have some more time. If time permits, I'll give you another example of 2D material, which is phosphorine. It is an allotrope of phosphorus, and it is a single layer of phosphorus, much like graphene. It has also similar features: high carrier mobility, ambipolar conduction. Due to this ambipolar conduction, you can make many nano electronics for faster circuit operations. And here is a comparison of phosphorine with respect to representative elements like graphene, TMDs, and hexaboron nitride. Graphene is a semi-metal. TMDs, the classic example being MOS2, which is a semiconductor. Phosphorine is a semiconductor. Hexaboron nitride is an insulator. One major difference between graphene and phosphorine is, in graphene, it so happens that conduction band and valence band are touching at one point, so you don't have any band gap. So whenever you are making a device with respect to graphene, it's always in the on state. Unlike in phosphorine, you have certain band gap. So if you want to make a transition, you apply something, and if an electron or a carrier jumps from one band to other band, that's how your conduction starts. When no voltage is applied, it has a finite band gap of 1.75 eV for a monolayer, and that band gap decreases as you are going towards bulk. But one problem with graphene, not only the one problem with phosphorine, is it is extremely sensitive to atmosphere. If you put phosphorine in room air, a monolayer of phosphorine in one air, within seconds it will react with atmosphere and transform into something else. I'll give you a simple experimental device picture. That is, here phosphorine was exfoliated on a 20 nanometer SiO2. E-beam lithography was used to make contacts, and here, instead of back gating, I used top gating. So I'm modulating carriers from the back using SiO2. I'm also modulating the carriers from the top, that is using the same principle, N is equals to CVG by E, where capacitance corresponds to C is equals to E ER by D. The main advantage of using ionic liquid as top gate is, whenever you are using ionic liquid, which is a mixture of positive ions and negative ions, what happens is they form a nanometer scale capacitor across the interface, and the distance between your the gate oxide effective thickness becomes 1 nanometer. Whenever your gate oxide thickness becomes very small, you can induce high amount of carriers. You can use high amount of carriers, and you can see the device performance at high induced carrier densities. And in this picture, you can see there are two different. So, in terms of circuit representation, this is the part. You see a layer called as PMMA capping. So that is used as a protective layer. The phosphorine, which is underneath that PMMA, is only exposed to back gating, whereas the other phosphorine layer, which is exposed both from the back as well as top. That is, the one which is highlighted in the yellow box, you can modulate its carriers both from the bottom as well as top. But whereas the one which is capped with PMMA, only back gating is possible. So let me first show you the back gated portion. As long as you are varying the back gate voltage from minus 10 to plus 10 volts, you can see the device performance. Since I am using this as a resistor, you can see in the inset how I can vary my tunable load resistance, how I can vary the resistance of the device from 50 kilo ohms to 10 kilo ohms just by changing the back gate voltage. And if you see the top gate, so whenever I'm measuring the top gate, what I do is I fix my back gate at a certain voltage. In this experiment, two curves are shown. Initially, the back gate is kept constant at minus 4, and then the back gate is kept at minus 8, and then I start to vary the top gate voltage, and again it shows the similar characteristics, transistor characteristics, both on the electron side as well as on the hole side. So here is the characteristics, output characteristics at a fixed back gate voltage and varying your VDS, and you can see nice saturation behaviors. You can see nice saturation behaviors, which is what you expect in a typical transistor. And what I did was, to this setup, I applied a simple analog input voltage of around 1 millivolt, or I guess it is 10 millivolts, and I got an output of 1 volt. That is, a gain of 9 is achieved using this set of 2D material at nanoscale. And its frequency response looks something like this. It has a cutoff frequency around 10 to the power of 1 kilohertz. Because of the parasitic capacitances that are coming into the picture during the measurements. So if you can avoid that, you can increase the frequency response of this particular material to higher frequencies as well. So this example again tells you, yes, 2D materials are the way wherein you can come up with analog circuits, digital circuits, applications, sensors. You can make wonders with this 2D materials. But what is limiting the current use of 2D materials is scalability and reliability. Because at this ultra scale, at this ultra nano scale, these are very sensitive. Whenever you are using a device, you use device in extreme conditions. And that extreme conditions will naturally affect the intrinsic properties of the material and they degrade the performance. That's one thing. Large scale mass production. All the devices in this talk are exclusively for mechanically exfoliated. There is no predefined or there is no reliable way till this date, especially with respect to phosphorine. Yes, there are some ways of making graphene using CVD, but phosphorine and other 2D materials, we still fundamentally are lacking in terms of producing large scale uniform 2D materials with minimum or no defects. Once you can achieve that, yes, these devices would be replacing the existing silicon based or germanium based devices. I hope till now I have given you a hindsight view of what materials can offer, how you can do material engineering, and how you can use technology like nanolithographical techniques to make devices at nanoscale. Very recently, I came up across a new branch of engineering. Yes. So what is this new branch? So what I said, graphene is a monolayer. So whenever you put one monolayer of graphene over other monolayer of graphene, graphene is traditionally honeycomb, like it is hexagonal in the unit cell, and if you put one graphene layer over the other, it forms carbon. But what you do is you intentionally put one graphene, top graphene and bottom graphene, with some misalignment, with some misalignment. That is, when two graphene sheets are placed on top of each other, when two graphene sheets are placed on top of each other with a small angle misalignment, they form a Moir pattern. That is what you can see in the picture shown. At the center, it's all hexagonal, but you move towards the edges, the perfect matching is missing, and there is a deviation between the bottom layer and top layer. The center one stacking is called as AA, the right side stacking is called as BA stacking, and the left side stacking is called as AB. By doing this, what happens is, when they're in AA configuration, the unit cell size is single hexagonal cell. But as you move from B to A or A to B, the unit cell size increases. The unit cell size increases and the physics changes. And the physics changes. It so happens whenever you are putting this material exactly at 1.1 degree, graphene becomes superconductor. In the previous example, during the start of my class, my lecture, what did I say? You can make graphene superconductor by putting external dopants, but simply by twisting an angle between two different layers of graphene, you can make it conducting. This is just observed in the last 3 or 4 months, and researchers are trying to come up with an explanation. There is no concrete conclusive evidence of what is happening there, but people are trying to come up. These are some of the interesting Nature papers, Science papers published very recently, like in 2021. This is a completely new phenomenon. And by using this phenomenon, just by changing the twist angle, you can modulate the properties of intrinsic graphene, which is a normal metallic or a semi-metal, to superconducting. That is, by varying the angle between 2D material layers, not only graphene, you can extend this principle to other 2D materials, and you can modulate the material properties from metallic to semiconducting to insulators. So normally, if you want to make a material insulator, semiconductor, or a superconductor, normally you change chemical composition. Whenever you are changing chemical composition, you are naturally changing its intrinsic nature. But in here, just by changing the twist angle, between one layer to the next layer, you can see in a single material system, different properties can be achieved. That is, if you rotate the graphene's angle with respect to one layer over the other layer, this is in the early stage. Even I do not have a conclusive answer for this, why it is superconducting. It is so projected that whenever this alignment is possible, exactly 1.1 angle rotation between conduction band and the bottom layer versus top layer, the bands become flat. The energy bands at the Fermi state become flat. Whenever they become flat, no matter how much of energy you give to the system, the electrons will not tend to move, and then they tend to stay calm and non-interacting. But however, when you apply external magnetic perturbations, like some temperature, some optical energy, some magnetic energy, they try to interact. But in presence of zero perturbation, they will behave as ideal particles, and that's how you get this superconductor. Again, this is not a conclusive answer for this. Researchers still working to get a conclusive picture. So we have electronics, we have spintronics. Electronics is there since, 1800s. Spintronics is very recent. Now we are entering into a new branch, which is called as twistronics, wherein you change the twist angle. By changing the twist angle, the properties of the material change. And this is a completely new avenue wherein people are really working with respect to different 2D materials to generate different Moir patterns and to observe different novel phenomena. I think I reached my time. So I just want to conclude that I have shown you what graphene can offer at the device level and as well as at the application level. I have also shown you graphene's high not graphene, graphene decorated with molygermanium, graphene decorated with molygermanium, and how it can produce high MR, wherein you can use it as a magnetic sensor. And I also showed you the intricate relationship between compensated metal, tungsten ditelluride, and how electron to hole ratio, manipulation of those electron to hole ratio is very, very crucial in understanding the physics of these materials. And I also showed you how a phosphorus, monolayer phosphorus can be used to implement an analog amplifier. And the gist of my talk would be, yes, you have a completely new set of materials, which is a 2D family. It consists of metals, semiconductors, and insulators. Depending upon your requirement, it can show ferromagnetism, it can show superconductivity, it can show ferroelectricity, it can show Dirac physics, it can show Mott physics. But all this is only at the laboratory scale at this point of time. In coming years, let's expect and let's hope that comes into implementation and technology matches the material aspects, and we see real-time applications of these 2D material-based devices. With this, I would like to thank all the participants for patiently listening to my talk, and I am ready to any questions if I have any. Hello.
Thank you, Dr. Lakshman sir, for your valuable presentation and experiential presentation. Now I request the participants, if you are having any doubts, you can put down the questions for 5 minutes so that we can go for a small break, and after that next session will start formally. Anyone wants to ask means you are welcome. You can unmute and speak. Your platform is open. There are 24 successful participants here. If there are any questions, please, you are welcome.
Either they might have completely understood it or got nothing out of it.
Better PhD scholars, please utilize this facility. This is upcoming FAB technology. So please utilize and ask the question as much you can. We are first time conducting this FAB technology oriented FDD for the very first time. So please utilize the opportunity. Okay, if there is no questions, then we will break for another 10 minutes and we will start formally by 12:15 for the next session. Hope Dr. Lakshman Raj will continue the same session after 12:15. Participants, for your kind notice, there is a feedback link available in your WhatsApp as well as in the chat box. Please provide the feedback session wise. Okay, session 1, session 2, like that you have to provide, not single feedback. This feedback will be available up to 11:55 only. Meanwhile, for the flexibility, we are still opening. So please give the feedback. Next feedback will be open by 12:35 to 1 p.m. After that, it will be closed. Like that, session-wise feedback we will observe. And 75% if you uploaded in the Excel sheet, automatically the certificate will be generated. We are not doing anything. We are not doing the process. We are not typing anything. Automatically, software will generate. So please give cooperation. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for your patience.
We will be back by 12:15 by exit. Thank you.